voices about how it looked. They came out with these big golden chairs and set Bishop Weeks and his wife out there. And I thought how foolish and ridiculous this is. Yes, and this is going on TV so they can hear me say it, because I mean what I say. Sitting in Detroit. That's just his ridiculous imagination and foolishness, pomp and circumstance. This is not what it is. The throne here speaks of a position of authority and power. So it says here, and they sung as it were a new song before the throne, before the seat of power and authority that God sits on. That's what the throne means. Don't get in your mind that it's some big ivory chair or golden or marble chair or something. This is simply not so. Can the church say amen? Because this is what men do. I was at a, Bishop Jakes was installing Bishop Weeks in his position as the presiding bishop of his new organization. Of course, I was asked to teach there at that event at Praise Power in Philadelphia. So I went out there. I didn't know that this was going to be what it was. And so after I taught, Wanda Davis was over here teaching in one class. Noel Jones was over here teaching. Bishop Weeks was in one class teaching. And so they rotated. Then that night, they sent an entourage to my room to come and get me. And so I went out. I said, for what? They said, the bishop wants you to come and stand with him and Bishop Jakes on the stage. And many people, I figured this was going to be on TV because they had the big camera with the rod, I forget what that's called, that they wave around in the air. But anyway, they had that there, and they had the major TV networks. So I sat up on the pulpit. I tried to sit in the back. I tried to hide myself. I was sitting behind George Bloomer. Some of you all know George Bloomer and Jakes. And so I was trying not to be seen because I was not there but to teach a Bible class. I didn't know that this was going to be a organizational transition. And so then all of a sudden they came out with these great big chairs. The back of the chair almost set as high as the back of the building back then. I'm hyperbolizing, but I'm saying this is about how it looked. They came out with these big golden chairs and set Bishop Weeks and his wife out there. And I thought how foolish and ridiculous this is. Yes, and this is going on TV so they can hear me say it, because I mean what I say. And so they called me over, and I went over with Bishop Jakes, and I was trying to cover my head up because I knew the TV was going to get me. So they asked me to lift my hands to pray for Bishop Weeks, and I saw the camera coming. I tried to do this. I couldn't do it. TV caught me, and as soon as I got back here, Bishop Herman came into the office and said, I want a meeting with you. I heard you were on television, and you're going with Weeks. I said, that is not true. I was tricked into that situation, and the next thing I know, Bishop Herman said, I'm going to make you suffragan bishop in the POW. Now, I don't know that he did that for that reason. I simply told him that was not the case, that I was asked to come and be a part of that without any knowledge of what was going on. And afterwards, I interviewed with Bishop Weeks. He asked me to be his assistant presiding bishop and CFO, and he said because he thought I had a lot of money. And I told him, well, I was not leaving the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World because this is the mother organization of every Pentecostal organization in the world. And why would I leave my heritage? Well, you see, then he set his son up. You see what happened to his son and Juanita Bynum. So obviously God wasn't in it because it never would have fallen apart. And I understand now that his son, after they broke up, after that pomp and circumstance wedding, they broke up, and his son lost everything. The church and everything went into foreclosure. All of the strip malls, everything went into bankruptcy because God wasn't in it. So someone said, what does that got to do with the Bible class? It's simply to say a throne is not a chair. Can we say amen? That's a long way of going about saying a throne is not a chair. So this is the way that it is. As we go back to the scriptures now, this is the seat, someone say the seat of authority. As they sung, and they sung as it were a new song before the throne and before the four beasts. The four beasts are symbolic of the New Testament church and the elders. These elders are the 24 elders that were spoken of in the 5th and the 7th chapter of Revelation. 12 of them represent the Old Testament patriarchs. Who are the Old Testament patriarchs? The 12 sons of Israel. And 12 of them represent the New Testament apostles. For he said to the apostles, you shall sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Are you listening to me? So this is then who it is. And they and the elders, and no man could learn that song, read on, but the 144,000 which were redeemed from where? From where? And you will see where they were redeemed. If you go back to the 7th chapter, you can do this in your spare time, and see where they were sealed in their foreheads, 12,000 from each of the 12 tribes of Israel. Can the church say amen? All right, and what about these? Verse 4, these are they which were not defiled with women. Now turn to someone and say, leave that other woman alone. Now, of course, that would be if you're married. Now, if you're single, you shouldn't have another woman anyway. If you're single, you should wait and get married. This is not popular today. I have the numbers from the Barna survey by George Barna that says that liberals were 4 times more likely to participate in unmarried sex, more than 3 times as likely to view pornography, more than twice as likely to lie and get drunk than those who describe themselves as mostly conservative. This is the numbers that are out there. They are atrocious because we are in the last days. But these that are in this number in the 14th chapter of the book of Revelation, of the number of the 144,000 who were redeemed from the earth, they are they which were not defiled of what? Of women. These would then be the Orthodox Jews whose hearts were turned to Jesus Christ by the 2 witnesses that preached for the first 3.5 years of the tribulation period that are recorded in the 11th chapter of this same book, the book of Revelation. These are they which were not defiled of what? Women. What else? For they are what? Virgins. And they make fun of virginity today. It has become a joke to many people. But it will get you to heaven if you will simply live holy. Can the church say amen? And this is male and or female. God is without respect of persons. So they are virgins. This is referring to the 144,000 now. Read. These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. Read on. These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God and to the Lamb. Well, if you refer to the 4 beasts, that's the glorified church. And those who will be in the glorified church will likewise fit this description. And of course, Christ is the first fruit. We are the first fruit, that is the church. And then the 144,000 are the first fruits unto God out of the tribulation period. Someone say, out of the tribulation period. This is who they are. And what else about them? Read on. And in their mouth was found no guile. Someone say, stop cussing. Read. Without be fault before the throne of God. They are without fault. They are without fault, Brother Sergeant, before the throne of God. This is who they are. Now someone said, well, who are they? I'm going to show you further who these are. Hold this in your hand. Let's go now to the book of Psalms 45. Give you an Old Testament scripture of who these are. And there are some that teach that no one will be saved during the tribulation period. That's a bunch of nonsense. Many of those who are in the nominal churches who are sincere will be saved during the tribulation period. Israel will be saved during the tribulation period. That is, all of Israel that will be saved. The remnant that God will save, 144,000, and then the rest of Israel will go into her millennial in the middle of the tribulation period. So Israel will be saved during the tribulation period. And then there is a number which no man can number of every nation, kindred, tongue, and people who will be saved during the tribulation period, but they will have to be martyrs because they will have to either have their head chopped off, or they will have to be beheaded or starved to death because they will have to refuse to take the mark of the beast. And we'll read more about that as we go on. But here now, let me give you an Old Testament scripture to identify these that we're speaking of in the 14th chapter of the book of Revelation. All right, verse number 13 through verse number 15. This is prophecy. Someone say prophecy. All right, let's read on here. Read on. The king's daughter is all glorious within. Her clothing is of wrought gold. She shall be brought unto the king in raiment of what? Someone say, that's the church. This is referring to the glorified church. The king is Jesus. The daughter that should be brought to her, or brought to him, her clothing is of wrought gold. She shall be brought unto the king in raiment of needlework. This has to do with the glorified church. We will be presented to Jesus Christ. And in the 19th chapter of the book of Revelation, we will enter into, even though it's all symbolic language, we will enter into a marriage, and we will be married to him. For we are referred to as the bride of Christ. We are referred to as the espoused virgin, and then again as the lamb's wife. All of these are biblical expressions found in your and my Holy Bible. Are you listening to me? She shall be brought unto the king in raiment of needlework. The virgins, her companions that follow her, shall be brought unto thee. Now this, the virgins, her companions. Underline that. The virgins, her companions. The virgins, her companions, have to do with the 144,000 and those who come up during the what? Tribulation period. And what are these? These are the wedding party. They are the servants, as we will see later on as we go back to the scriptures in the book of Revelation. They will be our servants, and they will be caught up in the first 3.5 years of the tribulation period and stand before God and his throne and the glorified church on what is called the Sea of Glass. And they will serve Jesus Christ and his church day and night. Now, someone said they're slaves. It didn't say they're slaves. It said they're servants. Can we say amen? And someone teaches that they're slaves in heaven. There will be no slaves in heaven. They're referred to as servants. Can the church say amen? Right now, we are servants. Even though sometimes it is said that we refer to ourselves as love slaves. But that's not what the Bible calls us. We are referred to as his servants and his children and his friends. Collectively, we are the bride of Christ, the Lamb's wife to be, and all the people say it. So please underline that. The virgins, her companions that follow her. These are those that we're reading about in the book of Revelation that come up and are caught up in the first 3.5 years of the tribulation period. The virgins, her companions that follow her, shall be what? Brought unto thee, verse 15, everyone, with gladness and rejoicing shall they be brought. They shall enter into the king's what? Palace. Now think about this. And what will their job be? Someone say servants. But they're referred to as the virgins, her companions. The virgins, her companions. In the book of Revelation, they're referred to as what? Someone say virgins. These are virgins. And as it says here, they, back to Revelation chapter 14 now. Praise the Lord. And let's read that one more time. Verse 4 and 5. These are they which were not defiled of women, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God and to the Lamb. And in their mouth was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God. All right? So this is the 144 what? Thousand. And this is what they will be, and they are with, if you didn't know it, you read the 7th chapter of Revelation, they are with the number which what? No man could number, of every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. But this identifies them further. Verse number 6 read, and I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people. Now, someone say, what is this? You just read what it is. It's the, he saw an angel fly in the midst of heaven, having what? The everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell where? Now, you need to understand, this angel is flying with what is referred to in this scripture as the everlasting gospel. What's the everlasting gospel? Salvation is by and through the shed blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. That's the gospel. It's the death, burial, and resurrection of who? Jesus Christ. It's salvation through the shed blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This angel is simply flying as a witness against all of the people who are left here during this period. There will be no one else being saved, even though this angel is flying with this message and carrying this message through the earth at this time. It is simply a witness against the inhabitants of the earth, because there will be no one saved from this point forward in the tribulation period. Everyone that will have been saved, or that will be saved in the tribulation period, will have been saved at this point. So he flies as a witness against those who dwell on the earth, and to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people who are left here. And this will be a witness against them, because the gospel will either be a witness for us if we make the rapture, or it will be a witness against us if we don't. The only message that will save anybody from sin is the gospel of Jesus Christ. I don't care. There are 4,000 different religions. Turn to someone and say, too bad. You better get the right one, or you're going to have trouble when this time comes. And so, praise God, we've got the right one. Can the church say amen? Amen. Verse 7 read, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of waters. And there followed another angel, saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Now, please, someone say, what is this? This is when this angel flies in verse 8 and says, Babylon is fallen and fallen. This is the end of the false church system. This is what Babylon refers to. Now, I don't know if you know who the founder of Babylon is in the book of Genesis. Give you a clue. Who? Nimrod. I don't know who said that, but somebody has some anointing out there. Can we say amen? Nimrod is the founder of Babylon. He was a mighty hunter. And he is the father of the false church system. He preached the first false message. Now, someone may say it goes back to Cain. I don't have any problem with that. Cain was the one that offered the first unacceptable sacrifice to God and was rejected. But Nimrod came out with the doctrine of fornication, because the word had been given to Adam that the seed of the woman shall bruise the serpent's head, and it shall bruise his heel. So Nimrod taught the doctrine that every man, because the seed of the woman was going to come forth through some man, and this was going to be the seed of the woman, that seed would be Christ, of course. He didn't realize that the seed of the woman would be through incarnation, would be through immaculate conception, and the incarnation of God. He taught a doctrine that every man should take every woman he came in contact with and have sex with her in hopes of her conceiving the seed that would be brought forth to bruise the serpent's head. Now, what is this called? Fornication. This is the doctrine of fornication. And turn to someone and say, here we are today. This is why we're in the mess we're in today, because of the doctrine of Nimrod. So this is what this is in verse 8. And there followed another angel saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink the wine of the wrath of her fornication. This primarily is spiritual fornication here. It's really not talking about natural fornication. It is really talking about spiritual fornication. But this is speaking of the fall of the false church system. Now, you know, there are approximately 1 billion Catholics out there. There are approximately 1 billion Muslims out there. The three great religions, you know what they are? Christianity, Judaism, and Islam. They really should be Judaism, because from Judaism, after Judaism came Christianity. Judaism was in existence hundreds and thousands of years before Christianity. Christianity started on the day of Pentecost. And then 600 years after Jesus died on Calvary came Islam. These are the three great religions. But the only thing about it is that the only way one can be saved is through our Lord and Savior who? Jesus Christ. So the false church system, this is what this is speaking of, is going to collapse at this time. It will begin to crumble or come down. It will be coming down. This is why he is saying Babylon is fallen. All right? That great city, because she made all nations drink the wine of the wrath of her what? Fornication. Now, of course, I'm not going to get on TV and talk about the Catholic Church, but there are Holy Spirit-filled people in the Catholic Church, are there not? I'll give you something about that in just a moment. But again, they have to come by the apostolic doctrine. Is that right? There are many sincere people in many different denominations out there. There are over 250 different Christian denominations in America alone. But they have to come by our Lord and Savior who? And the gospel that we preach. All right? Verse number 9 read, and the third angel followed them saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever, and they have no rest day nor night who worship the beast and his image, that's the false prophet, read, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. The beast is a man. I believe he is alive somewhere in the world today. The Barack Obama is not the Antichrist, so you might as well forget that. That's nonsense. And the reason why we know that is because we're still here. So no, it's not Barack Obama, but the stage is being set for the coming of the Lord and the manifestation of the Antichrist. Can the church say amen? So now this then lets you know what the end will be of the beast, the false prophet, and those who take the mark of what? This lets you know. They shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up for how long? For how long? For how long? Turn to someone and say, you better be in the rapture. All right, verse number 12 read, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. Verse 14, and I looked, and behold, a white cloud, and upon the cloud one set like unto the Son of Man, having on his head a golden crown, and in his hand a sharp sickle. Now, some people say this is Jesus Christ, but it said one set like unto the Son of Man. I will simply tell you this. This is one that is coming with a sickle. And he is going to execute the wrath of God upon the inhabitants of the earth. And this then is really is a description of what is going to happen almost at the end of the tribulation period. That's why we're really reading it here. It is not in direct order in the book of Revelation, but much of what we're reading here will come to pass at the end of the tribulation period. Nevertheless, someone say, nevertheless, read on. Say it, read on. Let's read. And the angel came, and another angel, came out of the temple crying with a loud voice to him that sat on the cloud, thrust in thy sickle and reap, for the time is come for to reap, for the harvest of the earth is ripe. Now, some idiots, these unlearned preachers, have taught this is the rapture. It's because of how confused and mixed up they were and how unstudious they are concerning the scriptures. This is not the rapture. This is the wrath of God. And you will see this as we read on. Let us read on. Verse 16. And he that sat on the cloud thrust in his sickle on the earth, and the earth was reaped. And another angel came out of the temple, which is in heaven, he also having a sharp sickle. And another angel came out from the altar, which had power over fire, and cried with a loud cry to him that had the sharp sickle, saying, thrust in thy sharp sickle, and gather the clusters of the vine of the earth, for her grapes are fully ripe. And the angel thrust in his sickle into the earth, and gathered the vine of the earth, and cast it into the great winepress of the wrath of God. And the winepress was trodden without the city, and blood came out of the winepress, even unto the horse's bridle, by the space of 1,600 furlongs. This is the battle of Armageddon. Someone say, the battle of Armageddon. I'm going to show this to you. Now, this is where God is going to set his feet down on the Mount of Olives. And the Valley of Megiddo over there where Iran and Iraq were fighting, right in Baghdad, is going to split and drop down like the letter L. And it says that those armies are going to come together. It's going to be the king of the south. He's going to be fighting against the king of the north. They're all going to be coming up to take a spoil. Some think this will be them trying to seize the land of Palestine and the Dead Sea, because the richest piece of real estate in the world is the Dead Sea. Because in the Dead Sea, there's fertilizer. And what does Gog and Magog need more than anything else? They need fertilizer because they buy their grain from America, because they do not have fertile fields. So it is thought that they will all come together, be fighting, and then they will see Jesus Christ coming in the glory of the clouds, and they will turn to fight against him. But when he sets his feet on the Mount of Olives, those armies that come to fight against him, the Bible says in the 14th chapter of Zechariah that he will speak and wax them in his sore displeasure, and their eyes will consume away in their sockets, their mouth, their tongues will consume away in their mouths, their flesh will consume away on their bones, and blood will run bridle deep to a horse. As you just read here in that valley, 200 miles long and a quarter of a mile wide, blood will be running like a river. And that 100 million man army that's spoken of in the book of Revelation, this is where they will stand like an army of skeletons. And if that is not enough, then he will call.